How many people? Oh, hell, we got six people already. Somebody out there, give me a sound check. Mine says I'm on. Mine says I'm loud. Mine says I'm live. Somebody tell me about that, if you would. There's Steve Lines, man. He is on top of it. Bob, Steve, what is up today? What is up tonight? Can you hear me out there? Hopefully this new microphone works. And if you see my lips moving, but you can't hear, then let me know, like, hey, I can't hear you. Because it says I'm on, it says I'm loud, it says that I'm going, says sounds good. You're on and you're live. I'm live. You know, I'm excited tonight. You know, the funny thing is I have been putting so much more time in these than I was before. And hey, there's Tom. What's up, Tom? And Gerald, salute. But I'm excited about it. I really am enjoying this, you know, the effort. I've got a whole whiteboard full of facts right here to the right. I've got a new microphone. I've got a new light system coming. It's not here yet. I'm hoping to be able to take this thing to the next level. Joe Baldwin Jr., Joe B, what's up? And I'm excited about it. I really am excited about what we got going on. And, you know, I've kind of lost a little bit of my history roots. And Kim, what's up? I just lost a light. But you know what? Cutting in and out bad. I might be coming a little strong with this system. I'll crank it down just a little bit and see if that works out a little better. We'll try to make sure that we get it going. Facebook user, what's up? You know, I kind of lost my roots a little bit on the history side of it. So if I'm cutting in and out again, let me know and I'll try to work on that as I go. This is a whole, everything's kind of a different deal than I had before, but hopefully the whole goal was that we step up our game and that we come at you with a little better system and a lot better information and a lot more fun, because that's the most important thing, right? I mean, the reality of it is we're not having any fun, then this is not going to be any good. So I had a lot of fun today because I went back through the videos and I was like, what's the most popular video that I've done in the last year? And believe it or not, there's two. One is the Superstition Lost Dutchman, right? Which we always know because it's already the one we did, the live show we already did, has a lot more views than any other. So that's a thing people love. And second, believe it or not, was the Oatman Massacre site. And it was really pretty incredible to me that, you know, there's a big demand for people loving history. You know, there's a big demand out there for people that like history. And the cool thing about Arizona is that there is a lot of history and there's a lot of cool history. Now I'm going to pull this up real quick. I saw this today and I'm going to show you this real quick. Now, one thing right there, 1912. Okay. 1912 is when we finally in the state of Arizona got statehood. Now, if you do the history, you realize that is so much later than everybody else, because in the Southwest, this is what's a mecca for lunatics, I guess. What other way can you put that, really, is that, man, this is where everybody came, whether he was running from the law or running from the Civil War or running from, you know, God only knows what. And there's so much cool history out there. And so, you know, I've kind of missed doing a lot of the history stuff that I really love doing. I love the history of not only the state, Southwest, East Coast, it doesn't matter. I mean, history to me is history. And what I love to do, which makes me really excited, is that when we take history and we, what's up, Tom? And so, oh, there's Josh. When you start putting the dots together and you go, oh, wait a minute. Because a guy that I found today in one of my readings as I was brushing up was a guy that actually did all the work on the railroad, to get the Transcontinental Railroad across. He ran into who else but Olive Oatman. Isn't that amazing how people stumble into each other? And, you know, there's a lot of stuff when that railroad came in that completely changed the whole deal. You know, we had what was called the Devil's Highway. If you're familiar with that, if you're in the Midwest or whatever, there is a road that was basically between Ajo, which is southern Arizona. It goes basically along the bottom near the border all the way across to Yuma. And that was a trail that they would take across. It was the world's or the United States' deadliest highway. More people died on that. When I say highway, it was a dirt road. But more people died on that than any other road in the United States. And the crazy thing about it is, you know, it went from being the deadliest road on the highway or deadliest road in the United States to completely not even existing. And all of a sudden people got on a railroad car and what was this desperate ride across the desert, you know, in extreme heat, became nothing. All of a sudden the rail came in and it's gone. Right. And that's really similar to the Oatman story. If it had been just a few more years back, as a matter of fact, 2-3 years, they could have been on a train and this would have changed the entire history of that episode. And so they were only a few years off of that. And, you know, they definitely had the money at the time that they started this journey to have got, you know, because they had 8 months worth of provisions when they left another place that I was there this year. And I'm going to show you a little clip of that is that they started off in Independence, right? Because that was basically the start, Independence, Missouri, which we were at this year. And so I'm going to show a little clip of that and show you where they started from. And we'll play a little bit of that and then we'll get into it a little more.
Really stoked about doing this. I've always wanted to do like a live, but we actually were in the location. And I wanted to do this for a long, long time. Paul, what's up? Good to see you, man. It's cool to see you guys and I'm all the way here, about 1,200 miles away from my normal desk. But, you know, I'm here and I'll tell you what, one thing real quick is that if you can see me sweating, man, the humidity in the Midwest is unbelievable. I tell you what, it is so... I never thought 105 or 106 would be comparable, but I'm telling you what, it is crazy. Mike, what's going on? Howdy from Payson. Well, I'm in Independence, Missouri. I don't know how many people out there have been to Independence, but one thing about Independence, and one of the reasons I wanted to do this was, you know, I had to go, we did a visit with our in-laws, which are awesome people, very hospitable and unbelievably good people, and I wanted to do this when I came here. Really a cool deal. 114 is coming, Brian. What's up, man? How are you doing? Who is it? Somebody just popped up and I missed him. Whoever that was, I apologize for that. This is going to be interesting because we're actually going, I'm going to take you guys on a journey. Now, one thing that's really cool about Independence is there's so many locations that you can get to pretty close to each other. So we're going to do a walking tour of this. And then it'll lead us into a couple other locations. Now, one thing bad about this is the COVID has shut down all of the museums and all these locations. So basically, the places that we're going to go, we couldn't get into. And but that's all right. We still go through the grounds and walk around. And you know, this is going to be we're just going to dip our toe in the history of Independence. And the Santa Fe Trail and the Oregon Trail and all those different things that came out of here. Now, this is my hometown. I grew up here, so I've always been a history nut. This is really where my history started, was in this location. And I just fell in love with history, and this was the place that I fell in love with. And it's going to be difficult for you to see, but now I'm going to show you real quick. So if you look down here along this ridge, now those are all trees, but if you can go back 150, 160 years, 1820, 20-ish, then what you would see was basically nothing. There was no trees lines across there. So what you're going to see is you're going to see some grooves or ridges running across this right here. And basically what that is they came through here. Now there is a stream down here where there was a spring and they used to drink from that spring, and that spring is still running this to this date, which is pretty incredible as well. Now they would camp here in this area. And again, no trees.
Pizza.
No, we got it. How the hell did that happen?
Remember that, no trees. So they would camp here, and this is where they would get ready to go on their great adventure west through here. How incredible is that? I mean, that this location, this is...
So, you know, right there, the first thing you saw was the swells where the wagon trains would come out of Independence, Missouri, get on the Santa Fe Trail, and there was hundreds of them. And then that site you saw was going to be the site where they would camp right before they got on their big journey. So this whole story about the Oatman Massacre started in Independence, Missouri, as far as the wagon train. There was the Brewster wagon train. And the Brewster wagon train started with, I believe, 43 wagons, and they were all going to Boston, okay, which was the holy place, right? So this wagon train was going to go out, starting with these people in the wagon trains, one of them being the Oatman family, and they were going to go, which was 120 miles from the location that they left their fate, right? And so that started this whole adventure, was that location, and they camped on that very area right there. That's where everybody camped before they left in that next morning. So what was exciting to me was that I was able to put those points together and say, okay, this is where these people started this journey. You know, and they talked about when they started this journey, how much fun it was. You know, they said when the initial train left Independence, Missouri, that, you know, it was like camping and it was like eating out every night, and they had all the food and all the provisions they needed and all the stuff until it started to turn bad. And so, you know, because of infighting, things like that, disagreements. So this massive wagon train, the Brewster train, they called it, started off in Independence with 43. And by the time they got 1,800 miles to Maricopa Wells, which is on the other side of Phoenix, there were three wagon trains left because of infighting and things like that. Again, if they could have stuck together, would any of this have happened? No, absolutely not. You know, so by the time they got there, now by the time they got to Picacho Peak, right, because that was the loop that was coming through, and then they went from Picacho over to the Gila Bend or Gila River. And so by the time they got there, they were down to just them. So a lot of this story as it goes has to do with the fact that because they couldn't get along, you know, I'm not saying it was the Oatmans per se, but as a group, they couldn't get along. They ended up by themselves. And so one thing to remember about these pioneers that left there was there was a good reason why these people left in groups, because a lot of them was not prepared to go 1,800 miles. You know, most of them got off the riverboats, run the Missouri River to Independence, got off the boat, bought their provisions either there or St. Joseph, which is an hour north on the Missouri River. And they would have left from one of those locations. They would have came in. They would have bought all their provisions in Independence and or St. Joe. They would have loaded up for what they considered to be an 8-month journey. So that was going to be about 8 months. They were not skilled at doing this. Most of them had never driven an oxen wagon before. Most of them at that point, from what I learned about from other people that were more knowledgeable on the trail itself, said that basically that most of these people and most of even the oxen were not even trained they got trained on the trail. And so everything was kind of like, because so many people were heading, hey, there's Tim and Mountain Man 530. So that's where this kind of started. So when you want to know why these people, what, you know, they grouped together, was because they didn't have the skill set to do it on their own. And, you know, if you would have looked at that, some of those videos I did in Independence and some of the mansions that I went to, the guy that was in that mansion, that creepy mansion I went into, he made his entire, one of his fortunes off the fact that he had the map to get them to where they were going, because they had to have somebody that knew what they were doing. And they would sell these maps, sometimes fictitious, sometimes real. But so this journey, when they left Independence, these people didn't have a clue, I don't think, what they were getting into. They didn't realize that, you know, this journey was going to be unbelievable. And all the stuff, Noon's Airborne RC, what's up? You know, so they weren't prepared for this just as well. So all of a sudden, you've got a recipe for disaster, right? So these people are heading west. They don't have a skill set to be able to head west. They're learning as they go. I mean, you got to give them credit. I mean, that pioneer fighting spirit, right? And so there was a whole deal, you know, and we won't even get into all the backstory, but because it could have been any train going out there in reality, right? And so this doomed trip was in that exact location. They crossed right in front of me, right? That's where the trail went. And that was the campfire area that all of them, everyone that run on that trail by the spring, started from there. And it's a pretty incredible story. So they all headed that direction. Now, anybody that knows anything, and I'm not the expert on this other than what I've read, is that there were so many things on the trail that could happen to you. You know, there could be illness within your group. You could be running a group of, there could be three different groups of 40 wagons. And by the time the last group got there, got to the next watering hole, there wasn't anything left. And, or, you know, there could be part of the wagon train could have disease. I mean, there was so many things that went on this journey west. I mean, it was incredible. And so all of a sudden they make it 1800 miles. So you got to give them credit. And by the time they're at Picacho Peak, so if you know Arizona history, Picacho Peak, and they're getting ready to head the next 120 miles to get where they're going, they're by themselves. And so all of a sudden, you know, I'm sure during that journey, they would have got a lot better at their skill set because they had spent so many months out there on the open trail, right? And then especially at the end by themselves. I mean, if they could have stayed together, even with three, there probably was a pretty good chance that they probably wouldn't have been taken, because the group that attacked them was a small group. And if there would have been two or three different, you know, groups of people, then they probably wouldn't have had the situation happen that happened. Now, one of the incredible things about this story that I love about this story is that, you know, we talk about the ancients not having any written history, that this story is so skewed on what happened. I've read four or five different accounts of this, four or five different articles, four or five different books, and they all vary to some degree. None of them follow one path. And the funny thing about it is the main character in this whole story, which was Olive, was alive. And so was Lorenzo. So two people that were there at that time, and you still don't get, the whole story, and you don't get the truth of the story, but you do have certain things that you do realize. You do realize that is the truth, right? We do know there was a massacre. We do know that the family was wiped out, except for basically the two girls and one boy who they left for dead. We do know that, okay? Now, we know that for sure, but we don't know a lot about the rest of it, which is amazing. But there's so much there at that location. If you get the chance to go see it, because that's what we're going to talk about tonight, is not just that, but we're going to talk about the Gila, the history of the entire Gila Bend area. So what happened at that point was they were on their own. they got, and if you've ever been in the Gila Bend, if you've ever been down in the bottoms, man, it can be treacherous down there. And I can't tell you the way it was 150 years ago, but I can tell you now it is really incredible. You know, the whole deal comes up to, so they're trying to get out of, and if you've been there, great. If you haven't, I'm going to show you. I've got another videos that we're going to watch a little clip of to kind of give you guys, if you're not used to that, what's up, Bob? If you're not used to that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this up and I'm going to tell you a little bit, and then we'll go there with that video and kind of take a look at that. If you haven't, you know, if you're from Ohio or somewhere, that you may not get a chance to come out here and see this. So you kind of get an idea of how this thing played out. So they spend the, that could be true, Tom. So the whole thing is, they're in this bottom, which is treacherous. The soil is loose, and I'm telling you, he's exactly right. Gila Bend will tear you up. It will tear you up. And so they're in this riverbed, right? And they have trouble getting the oxen and their wagon out of the riverbed. Because at that time, remember also, the Gila is flowing. I mean, it was trappers and it was always water running, and it was a real river. Right? Not like it is today, disappeared, gone, and full of DDT. That's a joke. Well, it's not a joke. It's really true, but it's another story in itself that we'll talk about. But so they had a hell of a time getting out. So what took them, and when you look down that hill, it took them the entire day to get that wagon and those oxen and that stuff up. And so you've got a group of people by themselves. You've got Marianne, which was his wife, which was 8 and a half months pregnant. You've got Royce. I think he was 38. I think he was. I'm not positive on that one. And then you've got an entire family. So you've got Lucy, 16, Charity Ann, 3, Royce Jr., 5. Was it Roglin or Poglin? I think it's Poglin. You got Olivia, 13, Marianne, 8. Okay. So you got a whole family, right? And so they're on their own, and they have just spent the entire day trying to get that wagon and them oxen up that hill, and they are spent. So part of this story has to do with the fact that they were absolutely just beat, okay? So they were beat. So by the time they carried this their stuff up this hill, which I'll show you that hill, they got to the top of the hill. And Lorenzo, which was, he was at that time, what, how old was Lorenzo at that time? Man, I don't think he was 16. I think he was, I'm going to have to check how old Lorenzo was. But he's the first one that noted these Native Americans. And so they wandered up when they approached these people. She had started to cook beans for that night. They had decided that they were going to make this trip at night, right? They were going to make it at night because of the heat. And so they were going to go on to the next 120 miles to their destination. And they noticed a couple of natives that were coming up the trail. I say a couple, there was a handful. And they came up and approached them. And so the first thing you might think of at that point, they only have a single fire rifle. They do have a rifle, but they have one, right? So they have one rifle from what I've read, okay? And so there's a group of three or four natives that come up. And from the approach that they talked about, it was pretty friendly. It was a pretty friendly engagement. They could speak Spanish, and so could Royce. He could speak Spanish. And so they conversed, and basically, you know, they asked for tobacco. They asked for some certain stuff, right? And it seemed to be okay, except for the fact that they asked for pinole, P-I-N-O-L-E, pinole, which is cornmeal. And he's like, no, we've got this entire family. I've got all these kids. We got one on the way. We've got all these young kids. And man, we need it. We need this. And so then they actually got to the point of where they started rummaging through what the Oatmans had. They started going through and doing what they kind of wanted to do. And so that's kind of where we stopped in the story, right? So, okay, we've got this, what seems to be something that's not going to be a conflict. It's going to be a fatality or fatalities. But a lot of people don't get, and one thing that I want to talk about is because, see, I get all the comments from these videos that we put out, right? I get all these comments of people like, why do you call them savages and all that? The West was a brutal, brutal place. There were rules set in place that were different than any rules anywhere else. And there was a lot of stipulations that went on as far as that went of how they took care of their business. It was just how they did business. It wasn't personal. And the problem with that, it was brutal. And so you have a group of people that are exhausted, that have found themselves in a situation they should never have been in, but it is what it is, right? And you have two people that are conflicting, two groups that are making decisions based on the fact that if you're starving, you're going to take whatever you want. And that's the way it is. Now, there's thoughts of, well, what if they would have just gave them it? Well, then they would have probably died themselves. So, I mean, they had to do what they had to do, right? And so there's a whole lot of stuff past that. But let's get into, there's Angeline. What's up, Angeline? Let's get into another video a little bit. So if you haven't been to that area, you can kind of set the scene before we go to the next level. And you can kind of see what they were dealing with and kind of open that door.
If you were here in February of 1851, you would have witnessed one of the most violent and brutal massacres in all West history. That day, six people lost their lives, and they lost their lives brutally. So, Roy's Oatman was with a wagon train, and they were heading west, as a lot of different families were. And they were running low on provisions, and they needed to make a shortcut. And everybody in the wagon train, regardless of the problems they were having, said the same thing. Don't do it, right? Do not take the chance on going out, because there are savages out there, and they're not going to have a problem doing whatever they want to do. But Roy's made that fateful mistake. Now, remember, he had six children and one unborn 8.5 months pregnant wife, and they decided to make that journey, the shortcut, six of their lives that day. Now, the first thing I want to show you is when they made that shortcut, we're on the Mormon battalion trail, okay? Now, what you had to do was come up this ramp, which could take all day. And one of the most incredible things, if you look on here, is you see where the wagon trains have carved into this volcanic rock right in here. They also say if you metal detect in this area, then you will find nails from horseshoes. Because if you can imagine those beasts of burden coming up this hill and what it took to make this treacherous climb up this hill.
You know, when you look at that, I'm going to shut that down real quick. You know, it doesn't look that bad, but remember, you know, that they had been all day long. They had been, unbelievable. And, you know, the way I look at a lot of this different stuff is, you know, everybody was, everybody had to go to a level to survive. So when you look at what people did, you know, I can't say whatever, you know, the entire Wild West was savaged though. All of them, everybody. I mean, that started with, you know, there was the wars before the Euro-Americans, the wars before the Spanish, during the Spanish. The Spanish were some of the most brutal, violent people that ever lived on this, that existed on this planet. They were in the same level as the Huns and the Vikings. And so when we get so wrapped up sometimes in this, the verbiage of some of this stuff, as far as, you know, some of the stuff, I mean, everybody did the most of whatever they could to survive. And, you know, if you're going to starve to death, what are you going to do? You're not going to starve to death. I mean, so I think a lot of times in this deal, we get involved with a lot of thinking that, you know, the world was a violent place. It was unbelievably violent. It was violent before and it was violent after. You know, you look at the unbelievable amount of brutality. But, you know, there was a way that you just did your business back then. And a lot of people, you know, they don't get it, that the reality of it was ancient exploring. All right, what's up? I love it. But I appreciate that. Thank you, man. You're awesome. I appreciate that. But, you know, the reality of it was you did what you had to do, man. That's what you did. You know, you did what you had to do to survive. And I don't look at that as being, you know, I mean, you want to look at the everybody that lived at that time to some degree. It was brutal, you know, and that's just the way it was. So I don't judge any of these groups for doing what they did. And so, you know, I just look at it as being for what it is. It's history, you know, it's history. And, you know, hey, was it a brutal situation? Absolutely, it's a brutal situation. Can I name 100 more that was just as brutal or more brutal? You know, absolutely I can. So see, I don't get wrapped up in all the different things that this group of people, they were more violent than other people. You know, you went to whatever level that you had to go to. You know, the Texas Rangers, for example, you know, they were not effective until they became absolutely as brutal and then became more brutal than the Comanches and then became this legendary group of these people that were just unbelievably brutal. And that's the level they had to rise to, you know. Custer had a standing order that if his wife got accosted, then as far as something was coming on, there was going to get into battle, shoot her in the head. So that's what he said, that was the rules. That was the standing order for Custer, that if a group of people, you know, were attacking them, then shoot her in the head. And so that's just the way it was. And, you know, it just sounds brutal, but you know what? Everybody's just trying to survive. And so, you know, I can't put myself in these people's positions on any of this different stuff, because I wasn't there. You know, I don't have to deal with that stuff. And so I look at it, you know, like that. So I don't judge any group, any of these people for anything that went on in the West. I mean, that's just the way it was. You know, everybody was violent and brutal, and that's the way they survived. And so, you know, I don't look at all that as being, you know, that, I mean, I've had people go, well, you know, these people killed them. Or then I had people go, well, they deserved it. And then on and back and forth. I don't get into all that. I mean, I look at what happened. I look at why it happened. And I look at the fact that, you know what, they made a lot of bad decisions, you know? And so you can make a lot of bad decisions today, as a matter of fact, you know? So when I look at that, you know, the savages is everyone that existed in the Southwest at one time. I don't think there was a group out there that was not violent to some degree. Now, so let's talk about that. So they get in this conflict, and the and they're going through the Oatman stuff. They get in the wagon, okay? And he's basically telling them that he can't, you know, he can't give anything away. I mean, my God, he's on his journey himself, right? And so basically they get back, they group together, they speak their native tongue, and they come back out, and they have war sticks, which are basically, if you've seen a cricket mallet. And they brutally beat him to death, all of them, with the exception of Lorenzo, who they hit four times. They say four times. He was running and ran off the cliff, which is right on that edge right there. And they left him for dead. And then they basically brutally beat the hell out of all of them, right? And killed all of them but two, right? So there was only two that were left at that time. Now, let's talk about that, because people talk a lot about a different stuff, okay? And people don't a lot of times want to believe that there were slaves, that they captured these people and put them into slavery. I mean, that's the truth, you know? That's the way it was. People don't like to hear that, but, you know, that is the truth, is that these people, I mean, people, slavery was used by the ancients, by the natives, by everybody. So a lot of times we look at that as being these are things we can't talk about. Well, that's not true. I mean, these things happen. And so they took the two girls, they killed the oldest one because they figured she was probably going to be trouble. And so they didn't keep babies. And now this was in their own culture. This wasn't something outside of it. There was a rule of thumb in the old West, right? And even pre, that you had to be able to move. You couldn't be having babies, and you couldn't be having people that were going to be out of trouble, and you couldn't have people that are going to be a pain in the ass. I'll just put it that way. You just had to kill them. And that's the way it was, whether we like that or not. That is the way it was, is that that's just the way it went. Was that they just killed you. I mean, they couldn't afford to, they couldn't feed you. They couldn't haul you if you couldn't move. So they took the ones that were old enough to be able to walk, and then old enough to be able to either sell, or what they were going to do, you know, whatever they were going to do to them. They had value, right? Whether they were going to sell them or trade them or whatever they decided to do. So they clubbed these people to death. They left Lorenzo, who ran off the cliff for dead. The thing that was amazing about that story is he wasn't dead, that he actually, and the cool thing is, I don't know the exact location of the cliff that he ran off of, but you can get a pretty good idea. And it's pretty amazing to think about this kid that ran off this cliff. And he actually ended up finding the rest of the other two wagon train and wandered around and survived that, which is incredible. Now, the first thing they did was they take the girls' shoes and they took their bonnets and they marched them 90 miles, right? They marched them 90 miles. And these were what they believe are Yavapais, but they really don't even know. So they believe that's who it was, but, you know, they don't even know what group of people were responsible for this in actuality, right? And so that's what's interesting about the story as well, is that they know who ended up with them, but they don't know who actually even did it, you know? And isn't that incredible? And again, these stories continue to go on. And we talk about, you know, the funny thing is, if you'll notice that that painted rock down there, when we first had that opening, that wasn't at the Oatman location, that was painted rock, which is an area they would have went past. And that would have been really weird to be coming by there and seeing all those petroglyphs and wondering what they meant and what they said, you know, is basically newspaper rock, and knowing that they might be in an area that they may not have wanted to be in. And so how incredible is that, that this story went on? And so we're going to fast forward a little bit to the fact that, that we really don't know what happened to these girls, other than the fact that even Olive, which was the older one, said that they were traded after about a year. Now, they hiked 90 miles almost parallel from Gila Bend north to Wickenburg. If you see Wickenburg, they were west of Wickenburg. But if you kind of know Wickenburg in your head, it's 90 miles from the Gila Bend, right north. And so they marched them for days to that location. And they ended up selling the girls to the Mojave. And they say to this day, that's what probably saved their lives, was the fact that they were taken in by the Mojave, and they were treated differently. And so there's a lot of stuff. Angeline kind of even made a comment on that. There's so much that we don't get and don't understand in this story. After reading all these books and all this stuff about that, we don't know exactly what happened to them. They said they were never sexually assaulted, either by even the first group or the second group. They say that, you know, she said that she's always treated with respect. She did say that the Mojave, when they traded for her, I believe two horses and some vegetables and a blanket, when they traded for the two girls, that they saved their life. So I can't believe they were being treated completely unbelievably good if they saved their lives by trading them. But that's what they said. And then they kind of got in with the Mojave. And then this is where it kind of really gets incredibly interesting. It's really kind of unbelievable how this whole story went after that. So you can take the first part of it and do what you want with it. But this part where they actually go into this group is really incredible. And the story past this is kind of more incredible than the actual what got them there to me. And to begin with, was that they became associated and they became part of this group, part of this tribe. And so there's a lot of people that want to debate this thing backwards and forwards. But what it appears is that they were taken in and treated as basically one of them. You know, she had a nickname. She got a nickname, which they said they didn't give nicknames to people that weren't part of the group. Now, the sad part was that her sister died of starvation. The younger one, she died of starvation when she was with the group. And then Olive had actually said that that one of the ladies that took her in, basically in the tribe, saved her by feeding her. And so she saved her life. Now, Olive spent 4 years with the Mojave. And she had the tattoo, right? And that's another sign. Here's where this really, to me, gets really interesting. Yes, it is. It is halfway basically to Yuma, if you think from, yeah, okay. But so they invited her in, and she had a nickname, which is interesting. The nickname's just as interesting. But she had the blue tattoo, right? And the thought was that you did not tattoo someone in the group that was not a part of the group, because there was a purpose behind it. So basically what that meant was when you died and you went to your location, I'm not going to say heaven, whatever, but when you died and went to the great unknown, that you could find your tribe. They would know by the tattoos on your face that you were one of them. So they wouldn't have done that. Now, some people, here's where it gets weird in this whole deal. Some people say that it's not that. Some people say that some people say that it's the opposite. It showed that they were slaves. Some people say it wasn't. Okay, I'm trying to think of the name that they named her. Spansta. Now, and so, okay, I'm going to give you the clean version of what that's supposed to mean in Spanish. And the clean version for that means that you have an appetite for. The other interpretation was, I don't even want to say this. It's bad, but it's bad. I'll go spoiled womb. How's that? That she, you know, who knows, because she was there. Now she had, you know, and she liked where she was at. It wasn't like, now here's another thing. She said that she had two children, and that she was married within the tribe. And then later she said she wasn't. So I don't know if that was the truth or the fact that she didn't want to, you know, say that, or, you know, the fact that she cried because she was leaving her two children when she finally got rescued. Now, fast forward, Lorenzo, who searched for them not forever, right? From the time that he was found, he searched for his sisters, which is very admirable, unbelievable, right? The guy never quit. He searched for his sisters until he finally found them, right? And he had Francisco go and interpret. And so again, they traded her again for a horse. Now, there's so many interesting things when it comes down to the guy that basically did the engineering on the train. The Transcontinental was, I believe, a guy named Colonel Whippet. I think it was Whippet. And I don't think it was Whippet Good, but I think it was Whippet. Now, he, I believe, did all the engineering for the Transcontinental Railroad coming from the east to the west. And so he was at Canyon Diablo and that big mess of the train and all that stuff. But he had done all that work. And he actually ran into the Mojaves. He actually ran into them. And these girls had a chance to escape if they wanted to escape, and they could have told them, but they didn't want to escape at that time, right? And then they also stated that Olive didn't want to leave, that she became part of the group. And guess what? She loved that life. And so it's so interesting that Lorenzo finally, they negotiated and they got her and brought her back, and they didn't even believe it was her. He said that when the two met, they just looked at each other for an hour because he couldn't believe that she looked and she had been transformed. And that's incredible, you know. And that's another interesting thing. Signifies a member, not property. Would you not be able to tell which one is seen? The members of the tribe have similar tattoos. Exactly. But then some people wrote, Don, that was a sign of a slave. And so, you know, and I would like to believe that one, that side of it just as well. But I find it intriguing. Here's what's intriguing to me is that even when we have all this written documentation of this tragedy, we still have 30 stories. And we have the girl that lived it that we still can't get the truth out of, as far as I know. Or there's conflicts. I won't say the truth, but there's conflicts to what really happened. And so it amazes me that this happened. And then so she finally is rescued. You could say rescued. You may say not. But it didn't seem like she really wanted to go. And so she had assimilated herself within the tribe and become part of it. Now, I'm trying to think, Parker. Same kind of thing in that deal where she became part of the tribe, right? Here's a woman from a completely different world. And what, Cynthia Ann Parker, that became a member of and became a power in her culture, which wasn't her culture, right? But there seemed to be something in that really was something that she had been seeking most of her life. And they said she never really, you know, and then she gets involved with a guy and they write a book, and then she does tours forever. And then she ends up at one of her tours in Michigan. She meets a guy named Fairchild and they get married and they move to Sherman, Texas, where she is buried. And so they all said that to that point that she still, you know, missed her original, this new family that she had become, even though the brutality. So the story to me is not really of savage or all that crap. I mean, stuff happens, man. On the Wild West, in the Wild West, you better have your gun ready because your shit's going to hit the fan, right? So I don't look at that. I'm more intrigued about the story of her choosing a different life, which definitely was not going to be easy, but she never really seemed to, she knew she probably should go back to where she was, but she didn't really want to, it didn't sound like. And then Mojave said many a time that she could have left anytime she wanted, that she could do whatever she wanted to do. But that's not what she decided to do. And so she decided to stay. But I just find that intriguing that you know, that her life got changed and we never really found the true story. Now, the guy that wrote her original documentary said that she survived a fate worse than death and he would not print it. Well, I don't know what that's supposed to mean. You know, I know it was a Methodist publication that actually did her original volume, and maybe they didn't want to put the kind of stuff that maybe really happened. But regardless of what happened and how it got laid out, she didn't want to leave, which is the most intriguing part, that she had found something in her inner soul that made her want to stay. And, you know, I don't think she lived to be about 65 years old. I think, man, what is her deal? Let me take a look real quick, because I think I've got her, here it is right there. 1837 to 1903. There it is right there. So, you know, and I was going to ask you guys, has everybody been to that location? Now, there is the ramp right there. If you can see my mouse right there, hopefully you can. If you can't, there's the, so if you never knew where this was at, this monument right here for the Oatman family, there up there, if you can see my mouse, is where the trail comes down. So it's easier actually to walk through that than it is to drive to it. It can be a pain to drive to, but it's actually fairly easy to walk down to. So it's, if you go down the trail, if you just hang just a little left, not a lot, and keep walking, you're going to run into it. And because it's a pain to get to driving. It really is a pain. They've made it a really difficult situation. But I think what a great story it is, you know, and there's tragedy, but then there's also, you know, enlightenment is to some degree as well. You know, she found a true meaning of what she wanted to, what road that she wanted to travel. You know, and it just depends on, and who knows, if you weren't there, it's pretty hard to say that was a good thing or a bad thing. But the reality of it was, it happened regardless, you know, and so you really don't know exactly how that played out, but I will tell you, people love the story of the woman with the blue tattoo. They love the story. I mean, it's something that now, if you look at another site that's got a posting on a video, it's got almost 1 million views. So history is not dead. Definitely history is alive, and it's alive all over. And the Southwestern history is just, I love the Southwestern history. And when you start putting these people together, you know, that this Whipple, in 1854, right? He ran into her, and here's the guy. And again, you go back to the fact that here's the guy doing a railroad that ran into him. So if they would have been 3-4 years later, you know, you wouldn't have all the fatalities on the road of the devil. You wouldn't have all the fatalities of the people going west. And so, you know, the fact that these places were that modern technology caught up and changed all that, right? Changed all that. Now, here's the great thing about the Oatman story. So it didn't start there and it didn't end there, right? The amazing thing about the Oatman area, which is in Gila Bend, is the fact that it's not just this one incident that happened. That's like a, just a, you know, that's just a scratch on the surface of the history that's there. There were ancients in that location, in that area, maybe up to 8,000 years. Even though I go back 2,000, they're believing that there were ancient men in that area 8,000 years ago. So the great thing about this location was the first time I went there looking for just basically this Western story, right? About these people that were this fateful trip that day that went up that hill and that massacre, right? And I had somebody comment on my page too that, what, six people? That ain't a massacre. And I was like, oh, well, I you know, I guess I'm massacre level. Maybe that's not, but maybe if it was somebody I know, it'd be a massacre to me. But it's just funny, the comments that you get on this stuff. But, you know, but the reality of it is this, is that that was just a thing that happened. You know, the Mormon battalion went up and down that hill. You know, they had wagon trains. They had stagecoaches. Man, the 49ers were coming through there. That place got to be extremely busy. And all my Wild West heroes, all of them, you know, Geronimo and all this stuff, they traveled those trails, man. They were up and down those. They lived and they died on those trails. And I love the history because when you stand on top of that hill, the first thing I noticed was there was a sleeping ring. Now, a sleeping ring is when the ancients would actually walk by the trail and then they would lay down and sleep and they'd have a wiki up built, something like that. So here's something 800, maybe 1,000 years ago, right by an area where they had this sign about this massacre, right? So, you know, the life and death of the people on the Gila Bend is incredible. And that's just one small story that goes with that, right? The reality of it is, man, there's so much history there. And so the first time I went there, I was focused basically on this Western story, right? And another cool thing about that also is that when Lorenzo left that area, you know, the cavalry didn't come in because that was Mexico. It wasn't the United States. So Mexico, the United States was farther north. So they were in Mexico. And they didn't have jurisdiction as it was. And so that border going back and forth changed that whole story just as well. And that might have changed the whole story of them going and maybe going after and do a raid because they couldn't. They were still in Mexico. And so those little things like that really get me going. But so on top of that ridge, what's really cool is there was a village of ancients, and there is petroglyphs all the way around that point that I didn't even know existed. And then there's rock formations all over that area. And so you realize that, Bob, thanks for coming, man. I appreciate you. Hopefully you had a good experience here. But I mean, I just love all these stories. And see, I don't judge one story from the next. I don't go, hey, oh, they were savages or this guy. No, we were brutal. We did what we had to do. We had to survive. And so I did whatever I had to do to survive. And that's how I look at all that. I don't look at any one of those groups as being more or less. You know, the war was on. They were fighting for their lives, all of them. And they did what they had to do. And that's exactly how I lay all this to rest. I don't take any of this personal. I don't look at one side as being whatever, right? It is what it is. And that's history. So I open the door to history being that way. And I don't judge it. You know, I don't look at all that. Now, I mean, we're doing a whole warfare thing about the ancients and all this warfare that they were involved in because people, for some reason, want to think that it was all cool until the Spanish came and it was all cool until this group came. No, it was war from the time that the man first came to this area and they're still fighting now, right? Go to Gila Bend at night. You'll find out. So there's so much ancient stuff there as well. So you have this just plethora, and I use plethora in a sentence, I think almost. That's crazy. Of just history that's dripping off this whole area. And that's one of the reasons that I would like to see something happen with Gila Bend, because there's so much history that's just there from Patton to the Oatman Massacre to the ancients to the most ancient man, right, was in that area. And it's just incredible. It's a credible story that she would change her whole life and get with a group of people from being forced to a point where she liked where she was at, that was so foreign to what she was used to being at. And so now I want to show you a little bit about other stuff that's in the same area, that is right in the same area. So when you go, and hopefully you will, and you'll sit on that hill and you'll look down and imagine that wagon train coming up that hill, and imagine that family that had been 1,800 miles by themselves, beat, coming up that hill and given everything they had to get up that hill, seeing those rocks that were carved by those wagon wheels from just the grinding of those oxen pulling that up that hill. I mean, it would have been absolutely brutal. And then you see stuff like this, which you're like, oh man, let's go to the 2000 years of history as we pop up here, and let's get into, I'm going to roll it down here a little farther till we get to. Now, this is on one of the points that's there as well. Now, there's, we got an ad. How in the hell do you get an ad in this? Sorry about that. We got another ad. How in the hell do you get another ad?
Okay. Hey, Jay, this is it. I think this is just another section of them.
Oh, yeah, that guy's got tools.
He does have tools. He definitely looks like he has tools. You know, I don't know if this is just the rock being a little different, or they're as old as they look. This looks like some of the oldest stuff. I don't know that it is, but it looks, I see them crawl all the way across that.
These, we were searched for open points. We've gone in a direction we weren't expecting to.
I'd have been mad if we got over there. We
found a solid panel all the way along.
Hey, John, he can come in here. Hell, there's shit down there.
How almost you have the
over this stuff, and it's pretty cool. We don't know what any of them means, but we'll try to get some of the footage back from the drone. Hopefully that worked. It didn't want to fly as high as we wanted it to, but we'll just have to replace it. Get something that works better, James.
You know, if you look in there, you know, one thing, oh, Joe B, I better pull that back down. Holy crap. Awesome. Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. That is awesome. Thank you, man. You know, right there, one of the things that you saw was there's a ridge line at Oatman that has a full panels of petroglyphs that go around. Now, again, you get to see the Oatman site. You get to see, you know, that area, and then you turn around, and then right by there are petroglyphs. And then if you go to the, if you look to the, what would be the east, there is sleeping circles and trails that are 2,000 to 8,000, maybe even older, that have, people have been walking on all over, that are unbelievable. Then you get into the very end right there, there are rock formations, right, that they have lined rocks up. So you have, it might have been done. You know, sorry about the ads. I tried to pull them out, but none of the new stuff, you'll notice because of the donations, I've been just rocking them completely out, right? So I've been taking those completely out. But if you look at that, the place is just filled with stuff, you know, that you can go see. So if you take that journey out there, You've got rock alignments. You've got a racetrack. You've got a racetrack is an area where they used to perform ceremonies, and it could have been athletic events. It could have been complete ceremonies where they would have competed, right? And then you get over there and you see these sleeping rings. And then you see these trails that are a zillion years old. And we have found shells in that area as well that we know were back between, say, 1879 and 1915. So in that realm of what year those shells were. I mean, there just is so much stuff going on there. It's absolutely incredible. So you get to the Gila and you realize that this was a unbelievable location to get to go see. And so it's just unbelievably fun to go there because you just get immersed in all this. You know, you had the Spanish-American War. You had the Mormon Battalion. You had those people that we were hunting down. If you went to Sears Point with us and you were looking for Kit Carson, those guys, they traveled through there, and the ancients had their capital near there, right? There was an ancient capital, you know, in the vicinity. I won't tell you where, but in the vicinity was what they called the ancient capital was there. So you had all this stuff going on that was absolutely incredible. And so, you know, and again, I don't get into the, you know, I mean, the brutality was the brutality. It was what it was. And you know, I wasn't in that situation, but I love the fact that you can go to these locations and, you know, there's still, you can still look down and you can envision seeing a wagon train coming up that hill. It still looks like, you know, to some degree, you know, the sad thing is that the Gila doesn't run anymore. The sad thing is that, you know, the water's being used for agriculture and there's nothing really left. There's certain places where it does run. But it's incredible. It really is incredible that you can go to these locations, you know, and you got to go on that deal with us at Sears, right? It was unbelievable. You can imagine those people setting those locations. So you go all over Gila Bend and what you have is one of the most special places that you're going to stumble across. And regardless of what history that you're seeking, there's all of it there. And, you know, I find that fascinating. You know, one thing that we want to do on all these shows is, you know, I don't judge on the history. It is what it is. You know, they do what they did, what they did. We all did what we did. We do what we do, right? And, you know, I don't get stuck in that. That's not the real story. The story is somewhere else involved with, you know, the perseverance and doing what you had to do to survive. You know, I've got a video coming up where we did forts, right? Where we went to a couple forts that the ancients have built. Now, the brutality at that fort would have been unbelievable, chucking rocks down on you, and you're up, you know, basically 30, 40 feet above, and you're trying to come up that hill, and that's exactly the way it was. And, you know, I'm not sure. Here's a Facebook. You know, we're not sure exactly where the next meetup is going to be. We're not exactly. Oh, there's Wilson James. I didn't see Wilson James up there. What's up? You know, I don't know when the next one's going to be. And, you know, this is a great site, though. I will tell you that it's one of my favorite places because there's not too many places that you can experience all of this, right? You can experience all of this. You can see stuff that you can see trails that are thousands of years old, and it's incredible. You can see some of the best petroglyphs anywhere. There are two routes up, one straight, one S-shaped, and straight one is the straight one is the older one. Absolutely, yes. The straight one is the original trail. Now there's other stuff down there that's just is amazing too. You know, that's just one little area. Now there is a family called the Fours, right? And they built a toll road, and so they built multiple toll roads. And basically, their deal was: yes, you're going to pay, and yes, if you don't, I'm going to shoot you with a shotgun. And so, you know, that's You know, that's the way some of this stuff works, right? And so it is what it is. You know, they took the time to build this road and spent thousands of dollars even back then. And you will find that you can still see the toll road if you're looking on Google Earth, shoot across the valley, straight across at basically west to east, and you'll see where it comes out of the, you'll see where the, where it comes out of the wash up, and that's the toll road. And that was the Forest Toll Road. And he built a couple different toll roads. And so that's just the way it was. You will pay the toll. And so that's the way that it worked. And they're buried down there. The Four families buried down there too. There's also a stage stop that's still halfway standing. It's pretty much gone, but it's still pretty much standing, or still was. There's some walls, I should say. And you just see that when you come in. Now, one of the problems with Gila is a lot of the farmers do not like outsiders coming down there because there's been problems with people raising hell. And so I kind of get that side of it, even though I don't want that to be a part of this. It is a part of it. So make sure when you go to these locations, we keep utmost respect and make sure that we take care of this stuff and we do the right thing. And the right thing is to take care of these locations so we get to keep going. Now, I will tell you, do not drive off the road in Gila Bend because you will end up getting in. Oh, there's Don. Awesome. Road toll. I appreciate that because I need a toll. I need a toll road. And that is awesome. And I appreciate that. Thank all of you so much. It means the world to me because that's how this thing is being. That's the fuel in the car right there. And I appreciate that, the generosity from all of you. So that's just some of that, you know, but the Gila Bend farmers have had so many people from the outside coming in. They've tried to shut a lot of stuff down, which legally don't have the right to do, but there ain't a hell of a lot you can do about it, you know, but they've had a lot of problems out there with, I think, their own, not outside. I think they've had a lot of problems with kids in their own area. And so they've kind of shut a lot of stuff down that we need to make sure that we're monitoring because, man, you want to get to go see this stuff. It's still cool as hell. It is cool to hell to go to the Oatman Massacre site. Then you've got ancient ruins. Oh, there's Todd Beck who came on. We haven't seen Todd Beck in 8 million years. There he is right there. OX07AF. Todd, what's up? Good to see you, man. I'm glad you came. So there's so much awesome stuff there. It is a place that's been one of my favorites forever. Now you can drive down that road. So when you're going down the road in is really pretty decent. It's pretty nice. And if you get ready to go, if you're driving that road and you go down, get ready to go down in the wash, you've went too far. You will take a left right before you get to that. Now, again, there are areas there that have rock alignments. Do not drive off the road, please, because you will run over them. And they're cool as hell when you see them. You're like, my God, they were building these rock alignments. And so do not please drive your vehicle off the trail. Stay on the trail. But it's an easy drive. And then when you get there, you know, you can see all that stuff. And then the petroglyphs are there as well. And the rock circles are there. And then right across the way is the rock alignments. And it's really incredible. It's a great place, man. I'm telling you, it's a place that everybody ought to get to go see. And everybody should go see. And what I love is when we talk about, you know, the story of the Oatman, man, people love that story. They really do. They're entranced by it. And they have been since it happened. It changed how people traveled. I mean, people found out about that and it changed all of them. I guarantee you there was nobody that went by themselves after that, right? And so it did have an effect. You know, it took a tragedy to get it, but it did have an effect. And so, you know, that's just the way it works. And then all of a sudden, boom, the train's in. And then all of a sudden, nobody's in wagon trains, right? You jump on the train and you go. How crazy is that, you know, that changed everything, you know? It changed everything. And so I love this part of the history of the Southwest, and I've been away from it a little bit. We've been so, not that history isn't the ancient stuff as well, but I've lost a lot of this, you know, I haven't been delving back into a lot of some of this Western history that I still love. You know, I love the 49ers. I love the Road of the Devil. I love the stories of those guys that, you know, Natina Haas Altus, where, you know, if you got to that point, to that ledge, and there was no water down below, and you had to climb the other 30 feet, 40 feet up the next level, and you were too tired to do it, you died on the spot. And 60 plus people died there, right? And so how crazy is that? But that's our history, man. That's all of it. And, you know, our history is good and our history is bad, but it's our history. And it's all of our history, you know, whether, you know, we have ancients eating people or sacrificing people, it is what it is. You know, we had a massacre, you know, it was what it was. And I don't say that couldn't be considered or construed to be sad, but there was a lot of sadness, you know, a lot of sadness when the Spanish killed half of the Native Americans, the ancients, with their diseases. But that's what happened, right? It happened. And so that's what we have to look at. And I love all of it, you know. And again, one of my favorite people is Geronimo. And Geronimo had a little pretty checkered past himself. But you know what? It doesn't take away from the fact of this, the legend that he put out there for himself. I mean, this Oatman deal, man, a lot of people are interested in it. A lot of people know about it. And it was the number two video I put out. So it tells me that people love history. That is the way it is. And I love all of it, though. I don't mark one side or the other. There's no winners or losers in any of this stuff. You know, you look at the Civil War, everybody lost. I mean, there was no winners in the Civil War. I mean, and you know, again, a lot of people want to believe that, you know, a lot of stuff started at certain times, and the reality of it is it's not true. They've been doing this forever. You know, the ancients were taking slaves forever. You know, it was what you did, and it was acceptable. And if you were too young to travel, they killed you. That was the law. That was their rules, and that's what they did. And they had a purpose for it, because they couldn't haul children, right? So they didn't. And a lot of people get pissed off at that, but the reality of it is, the Spanish, I mean, unbelievable. I mean, how unbelievable was that, you know? And that's actually that, and that is our history, you know, and that's part of it. And it just goes to show you how brutal. I mean, the Spanish were brutal. I mean, you talk about groups that were brutal. I mean, they were brutal. And, you know, Tom's talking about the Wickenburg massacre up there. You know, that was an interesting story. I mean, it's still interesting. It is history. It is stuff that happened. It was exactly what happened. And it doesn't mean we can't be saddened by some of it. But you know what? You don't hide it. You know, I mean, that's what happens. You have these continents. What amazes me about Spain, though, and this is what amazes me, is that the Spanish, you know, they were global gods in a sense, right? I mean, they traveled everywhere. These guys were badasses. I mean, these guys were ridiculous. I mean, and you talk about brutal. I mean, they were brutal. Most of the conquistadors came from a part of Spain that was very similar to Arizona, and it was hotter than hell. So they didn't care. So that even didn't help either. And so, you know, here's these people coming in here, and I still think about this, and it really, to me, is a big deal. Can you imagine the first guy that saw somebody in a metal suit riding some beast coming at you? And you've never seen anything like this. You want to talk about somebody seeing aliens? I mean, oh my God, what would that have been like? You know? And then another interesting story to me also is that, you know, so here's a group of people that never had horses at all, but see what these guys are doing. They steal them and they become the master horsemen, and that's the Comanches. The Comanches were unbelievable. So they take and steal these horses from the Spanish, basically, and then they become masters, master horsemen. Their ability to hunt and to fight on horseback is legendary, which is really cool to me to show the adjustability, right, of these people and these cultures to embrace this new technology, whether you want to call a horse a new technology or steel, right? All of a sudden they have blades, there's steel, there's metal. You know, most of the people die to disease. Because remember, you come from these black plagues and all this stuff and these rats that are on the ship and all this stuff. And all of a sudden you bring that crap where these people have been fighting those viruses for so many years. They become immune, like all of them do. You become immune to that, right? Because you've died from it in cultures and different generations. And then you bring that somewhere where they haven't had that and you wipe everybody out. It's a wonder they didn't wipe everyone out. It really is. It just goes to show you that the immune system of the strong survived. And all of a sudden, guess what happened was they adjusted, right? And they didn't only adjust to the diseases, they adjusted to the fact that they took the technology, and I'll call it horse technology, and they took that technology and they not only got good, they mastered it. The Comanches are legendary warriors, legendary. And they're legendary for a whole lot of reasons. They are the torture kings as well. And what I find interesting was the women were the ones that did the torturing. Steve Lyons, the women did the torturing. Isn't that unbelievable? I mean, to me, it really is. And you know what? Why? Well, why would they do that? Why would there be a Comanche moon, right? Why would there be all this stuff? Because you know what? If you were going to have to fight people, you want them to fear you. And you think they were the first people that actually did that? Hell no, they weren't. You know, they wanted you to be afraid of them before they even showed up, right? And so it's an incredible story. It really is. And so I love this part. I love the West. I love the people that had to travel from Independence, Missouri on all the different trails, right? That had the fortitude. And even though they didn't start that trail as being, hardcore, you might say, man, by the time they hit the road, they became that, right? And you know what? Regardless, they'd be able to come 1,800 miles in a wagon, an oxen. My gosh, you talk about they got tough, right? They got tough. And so, you know, there's a lot of things you could look at, but you know what? It is what it is. And that's what happened. And that is the history, right? That is the history. And so, you know, all of this history fascinates me. But I mean, sometimes we get locked into this hole that, well, this didn't happen till this group came and that didn't happen till that group came. No, man, when the men came on, when people wanted were going to starve and they decided that they wanted your food, they were going to take it, you know? And so I looked at that, that's exactly true. And you know what? Let's call it straight out. You know, it was brutal and it was brutal. And did they break all the treaties? Hell yes, they did. You know, I mean, that's what they did, you know? And sounds like my, but she's exactly right. I mean, that stuff really happened. And that stuff should be secrets to me. It should, none of it, you know, there's no secrets in history. If you're keeping secrets in history, then you know what? I mean, I'm going to throw this out there. Now, remember this. The Gila Bend River Valley has the highest rating of DDT of anywhere in the United States because they dumped it there thinking that they were killing the boa weevil and they poisoned the whole Gila Valley. And that was in the 60s. That wasn't like 1900 when you're like, well, they're too dumb to know. The U.S. government dropped Agent Orange on the San Carlos Reservation. Yes, that's real. And so, you know, it is what it is. I mean, you know, I don't hide any of this stuff, man. I wanted to, so, you know, that's what I want to be a part of. I want to be a part of people that just, this is what happened, man. This is the way it was, you know, and this is the way it worked. And so, you know, we don't teach this stuff in school. You know, we don't teach any of this stuff, you know, just like Angela, but I'm not a teacher by no means. I'm just a history junkie, but I just believe that we need to know all of it, you know, and we need to not look at our history as being, oh, because we ate people, we're bad. If we did what we did. Okay. That's the way it was. Right. Or whatever that scenario ends up being, but that don't mean that's who we are today. You know, we need to learn from our history so we don't repeat it and we don't keep doing stupid shit, right? But we got to know what it is without being filtered. And so all the groups have to be a little more open to the fact that we got to just open ourselves up to the fact that this is what we did and this is what we do. She's exactly right. They did that. You know, they killed off the buffalo, right? For what reason? So they starved them out. That's the what they did, you know? I mean, you know, and then you look at even, I love Geronimo, but he did some dirty, I mean, unbelievable things, you know, whether he was justified or not justified, but I don't dislike the guy. I mean, I respect what he did and how he did it, even though he did some stuff that, you know, and he didn't die on the most noble terms, but that doesn't mean that, oh, I'm going to wash out his entire life because he did one thing here, one thing there, right? You know? Look what the Spanish did. Look what the Mexican-American War did. Look at the Comanches. Look at all these people. Look at all these cultures. Look at these ancient people that I'm studying today that I know were brutal. Look at the ones that were eating themselves. I mean, all this stuff on and on and on, right? But you got to open it up and say, you know what? Let's look at this. Let's look at this. And I just believe that. And that's what this is where I'm coming in 2021, man. I'm going to tell all the stories. And if they beat people with mallets to death, they beat them with mallets to death, right? That's what they did. But that's what they did. They weren't more brutal than this group. That's the way they had to live their lives to survive. And so, you know, I love that. Oh, there's super sticker. Bam. I don't even know what a super sticker is, but I love super sticker, Steve Lines. I'm just going to let you know that just as well as the rest of the crew that have donated tonight. And I appreciate you guys so much. Let me know how you like the new format. Let me know what you like, what you don't like. There's one from, let's take a look here real quick. That's how you know it's bad. I used to cringe at my dad's belt. I was straight up terrified. My mom would go out and cut a switch off the tree. And that, remember, go cut a switch. That was like you had to go cut your own switch. And I would bring in this little twig and he would get a log and I deserved every bit of it because I did a lot of stupid stuff, man. Tim, what's up? And so, you know, hey, that's what we're going to do. You know, if people are going to like it or ban us or whatever they're going to do, you know what? We're going to call this stuff out, man. We're going to call this stuff out. You know, the Wild West is ruined by Hollywood. You know, all these guys going out in the middle of the street, all these guys, they're going to face off like men. That happened like once. And the rest of them, they shot him in the back. Okay, that's the way this stuff really went down. Jesse James was a serial killer. He was a psychopathic serial killer. And that's all he was. And that's what he was. And he never robbed from the rich and gave to the poor. There's no documentation of that. He had a writer on the Kansas City Star that was pro-South. So he wrote good press about him. And Jesse James got to a point where he was actually sending press releases to the paper. And then, you know, that's what it was. But, you know, the Civil War gave a lot of psychopaths a great opportunity to kill, and they were good at it, and they got damn good at it. And so that's what they evolved. You know, we don't talk about, you know, on the battlefield of California, was it California, California, Missouri? No, it wasn't California. It's like Moberly. No, but it's coming to me. They had a war. They had a battle in the Civil War or pre-Civil War, because the two sanctions were fighting, the bushwhackers, and the border ruffians basically were fighting, and they were pissed off at them. So when they ended up finishing the battle, they cut everybody's heads off and left them in the field. Now this happened in the Civil War. You heard about that? You know, have you heard about that stuff that's documented, that they cut their heads off and mutilated their bodies? And so they did it. And guess what happened next time? Then they did it, right? Okay. Then the Jayhawkers came over and did it to the bushwhackers, right? And so that stuff is real, and it's real. And we need to know that stuff. We need to know that stuff existed. You know, we need to know, I think we do, you know, and you know, most people don't realize that, you know, that war there had nothing to do, absolutely nothing to do with slavery, really. There was a bunch of people that wanted to rob and steal legally, and that's what they did. Let's see what, I love soiled doves. I love that story. I love going, I mean, women had, and I'm just going to, I'm running over, but I'm going to run over because we're talking about soiled doves. Man, they had it rough. I mean, come on. If you've did any of the research on this stuff, it is absolutely unbelievable how tough they had it. And, you know, how difficult. And, you know, then you want to throw the church into it, where they weren't going to come west unless they had some type of, you know, religious, the churches to keep them somewhat straight. And then they had all this stuff. If you go to Maddie Blaylock, right, who killed herself in when we were down there looking at that city down by Superior, right? It was unbelievable. I mean, it was unbelievable. You know, a lot of these houses of ill repute are still standing in Superior, Arizona. You go to Jerome and you have the, what do they call it? The Bachelor's Walk. So they had all the houses of prostitution on the backside of the town. So you'd walk through you'd walk down the stairs and around the back. And I found it, you know, even Western prostitutes, I found it intriguing all the way up to all the houses of prostitution that they had in Hawaii. I found that to be unbelievable. I mean, I was just unbelievable. And so I love all that. I mean, all that, it is who we are. However you want to slice it and dice it, it is who we are. It all has some effect on where we become and who we are today. All that stuff, right? And then what it was absolutely, totally acceptable, and then it wasn't. So where did that change in thinking happen? You know, what was that? What was that progression? You know, I like to look at that part of it. What changed us? Okay, so now we're not going to do this. We're going to do this, or we're going to do that. And Pinal City, that's right, Kim. And, you know, you look at those people and you follow them and you follow their lives and you do any of the research on the soiled doves. You know, one of the things I love, one of the stories I love, and I get into this, as you can tell, is the story about the gal that ran the house in Tombstone. And she was Chinese. And she ran that town, because you got to remember, she was the banker. And so she gave the loans because she had the money. Who was getting all the money? These guys would go in the mines and they would kill themselves, and they would come out and they would get two things. And drunk was one of them. And the other was the fact that they would leave with no money. So where did all the money funnel into? With these houses of ill repute, all the money funneled into them, and they would actually be more of the financial backbone of the city. And I love that story. I love the fact that that's where the money was. It wasn't in the bank. You know, the money was going, was routed through these different places. And if you ever been in a mine, a real working mine of the old style, and you find out how filthy it is and how dirty it is and how nasty it is, and the hard work you would have had to done to become a miner and to come out and get your $5 or whatever you had, and then on Monday you didn't have any money, it would suck. That would suck bad. I'm just letting you know that would not be good. But I, again, I love all that stuff, but I like to find out where, you know, again, you know, they didn't have any gunfights in the street. They come around the back and they shot you in the back of the head. If they thought that you were going to be faster, you're going to kill them. Why in the hell would you fight somebody and die? You weren't going to do that, you know? But I love the stories and I think it's great. And absolutely, I'll get into all this different stuff as I travel back a little more into the history side of it. I want to thank Bob. I want to thank Steve, whoever the Facebook user was. I think they said earlier down there, Gerald, Tom, Joe, Kim, Josh. Let me see where the faith. Tom, I think we said Arizona Times Tourist. It's always good to see Dean. And there is Neil and Mountain Man 530 and Noons Airborne RC. And who else do we have? We got Angeline, great site in Ancient Southwest. Go see her. Go see her site. Ancient Exploring. Always go see Ancient Exploring. He always takes care of me. And there he is taking care of me again. I think I said Kim, and I know I said Angeline and Don. And there's Joe B again. And there's Joe B. Thank you, sir. Much appreciated. Don, thank you, sir. There's Don. And there's Todd. I haven't seen Todd forever. There's Paul. Steve again, thank you. And there's Kim at the end. Man, I want to thank everybody. Had a great time tonight. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Hope you had fun. I appreciate all of you hanging out this long. We're going to get this thing ramped up. I got more stuff coming. I've got different lights coming. If you don't like anything you're seeing or the light or something's changing from the side that you're seeing that you don't care for, email me. I am here. Email me here. Right there. And there I am. And you can get a hold of me there. If you want to talk to me, you want to chat with me, you want to talk about anything in the Southwest, that's where I'm at. And I appreciate everybody for coming and thanks for the donations that makes this thing go. You guys are awesome and I appreciate it. And, hopefully every time you see it, we'll ramp up a little bit. I'm putting new stuff in. We're getting new stuff. I'm figuring out how to work the software. You're going to see, hopefully it'll be a little smoother. No more commercials, hopefully. And thank you, Kim. I appreciate it. And so everybody have a great evening. You guys are awesome. And we're going to end and have a great evening. Now, one thing real quick. If you like really weird, on Saturday night at 9 o'clock, we go on the Lost Highway. And that gets a little weirder and a little newer. And I'm not sure what the show is. This, I haven't written the show over this week. Thanks, Tim. I appreciate you, man. I think we're going aliens. I'm just going to say, I think we're going aliens on the Lost Highway. So if you like that, no, thank you. I appreciate it. Man, I appreciate getting to do this. And again, on Saturday, if you got nothing going on, we're going to get a little weird because Saturday gets a little weird. And I want to appreciate everybody that came and chatted. It was awesome. Had a great time. I will see you again next Tuesday. And if you want to go down the Lost Highway, 9 o'clock, Saturday, see you.